Why String Theory by Joseph Conlon. Read by Robbie Stevens. Preface. This is a book about string theory. I started writing this book in 2010 with two motivations. The first was a desire to give back to those who have given to me. It is an incredible privilege to be paid to think about science and fundamental physics, and those who pay the piper have a right to hear the tune. The second was an intent to heed advice passed on to me since childhood. Learn as much by writing as by reading. Writing is fun, and I wanted to go beyond the technical prose of journal articles. This book is written in response to the questions of what is string theory, and why do you work on it then? And it aims to answer them. String theory is, however, a large subject. Over its history, there have probably been over 20,000 research papers on it. No one, and certainly not myself, knows all of this work in detail. Writing a book requires an ordered account. In arranging material, I have had to select topics, and in selecting, I have aimed for the combination of intrinsic importance and personal familiarity. To state the obvious, this is not a textbook. It does not have equations. It will not teach anyone either to do calculations in string theory or to perform research in the subject. There are many good textbooks that do precisely this, and I give references to some of them in the bibliography in the print edition of this book. What I hope the book does provide is a mental map of the subject, a tourist's guide to those who want to come and see the sights before returning to their own pursuits. I also hope that it may allow those who aspire to a career in the area a chance to reconnoitre the lay of the land. To these ends, I have aimed to describe the physics as accurately as possible, consistent with the constraints. Accuracy is not a single standard. The geography of the British Isles can be accurately described either as two triangles or through a bookshelf full of Ordnance Survey maps. Neither is right or wrong. It depends on the desired level of description. I have aimed my account of string theory somewhere between these two extremes. The book is designed to be listened to sequentially, but this is not an absolute requirement. A listener already familiar with the big picture of known physics could skip over the first part with a little loss. In the third part, on the different applications of string theory, the chapters can be listened to in any order. The 12th chapter, on the different styles of scientist, stands alone by itself. One of the joys of physics is that it is a connected subject. Ideas repeat themselves, and on occasion in this book the same idea comes up more than once. When this happens, I have sometimes allowed myself to re-explain concepts rather than expect the reader to remember an explanation from 100 pages earlier. It always takes me multiple attempts to understand any concept, and in seminars I find few things more annoying than the speaker who believes that a single mention of an idea allows them to deny the audience any further reminders or clarifications of the topic. When quotations occur within the book, I have gathered the details of the original sources into the endnotes and bibliography in the print edition. Part 1. Why? Chapter 1. The Long Wait. The 25th of June 1973 did not appear special. The Watergate scandal was rumbling on towards its denouement. In New York, the twin towers of the World Trade Center had opened 2 months previously. Nearby, on Long Island, around the offices of the Physical Review, it was warm but not hot, with neither rain nor wind spoiling a pleasant summer day. The latest issue of Physical Review Letters, the prestige journal of the American Physical Society, had just gone to the printers. Among the articles in the issue that day were two on particle physics, appearing one next to the other. The articles addressed the same topic and had both arrived in the mail 6 or so weeks earlier. The first was by David Gross, a young 32-year-old associate professor at Princeton University, together with his first graduate student, 22-year-old Frank Wilczek. The second paper was by David Politzer, not much older at 23, who was then a graduate student at Harvard. The respective titles of the two papers were Ultraviolet Behavior of Non-Abelian Gauge Theories and Reliable Perturbative Results for Strong Interactions. both papers addressed the same question: how the behavior of certain physical theories varied when examined at large distances compared to when they were examined at small distances. The papers had been received at the journal's offices less than a week apart, and after favorable review were now appearing consecutively. So far, so ordinary. However, from the perspective of 42 years on, what is special about that summer's day in 1973 is that, at the time of writing, it represents the last time work in theoretical particle physics was published that would subsequently go on to be awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics. There are four known forces in nature: the gravitational force, the electromagnetic force, the weak force, and the strong force. The gravitational force is familiar, as are the effects of electromagnetism. The strong force serves to hold atomic nuclei together, but it is entirely absent in the macroscopic world. It remained mysterious for years how the physics of the strong force could be so important in the nucleus and so irrelevant everywhere else. This physics was even more mysterious during the 1950s and 1960s, as a vast zoo of particles all interacting under the strong force were discovered, one after another, after another. The behavior of the strong force appeared bizarrely different to any of the others, and at the time it was thought the strong force might defy understanding for 50 or 100 years. It did not. Despite many opinions to the contrary, the equations underlying the strong force were in fact similar to those underlying the electromagnetic and weak forces, and the apparently inexplicable behavior of the strong force was, surprisingly, understandable in terms of known theories. The work of Gross, Politzer, and Wilczek was the key to showing this, and for this discovery they would, in the fullness of time, be awarded the 2004 Physics Nobel Prize. Since then, there have been more recent Nobel Prizes in particle theory, such as the one won by Peter Higgs and François Englert in 2013. But these have been for work done even earlier than 1973, in 1964 for the case of Higgs and Englert. This has been neither for want of papers nor for want of effort. It is a stubborn truth that the theory that had just about been written down in the 1970s as an approximate description of nature, the standard model, has turned out to be far better than anyone could conceive or imagine at the time. The standard model is the modern description of all known elementary particles and their interactions, and it has survived all experimental attempts to prove it wrong. Tests that in the 1970s were either only qualitative in form or even only an experimental dream have morphed into successful high-precision probes of the fine structure of the standard model. Over this period, many proposals have been made for new particles and new phenomena beyond those already in the standard model. Indeed, there have even been some experimental claims to have found such particles. However, these claims of discoveries have not held up, and the proposals have failed empirical test. No such new particles have yet been observed. This history is full of many experimental triumphs and first discoveries of new particles, most recently the 2012 discovery of the Higgs boson at CERN's Large Hadron Collider, but these all involve discoveries of previously unobserved particles of the standard model. It is not impossible that some of these proposals will eventually turn out in some form to be correct at energies that are beyond current technology. There is, however, so far, no positive evidence for this, and as new experiments replace old ones, the young bloods who, with dreams of Stockholm, wrote down ideas for new physics, are now admiring the first hesitant steps of their grandchildren. The big picture of the last 40 years, then, is the consolidation of the standard model from a house of straw into an enduring edifice of high-energy physics. Over this long period, this fact has led to two broad directions of thought. The first has been towards bettering our understanding of the standard model. This has involved answering in ever greater detail the questions: what are the predictions of the standard model? What is the most efficient way to work out these predictions? At first, no one could have realized that this was the path they were headed down. The standard model originally appeared a temporary ersatz construction that would be good for a few years until something better came along. Understanding the predictions of the standard model and discovering the new physics that went beyond it did not appear to be separate enterprises. They were different sides of the same coin. However, with the passage of time, the machinery required to compute the predictions of the Standard Model has grown increasingly elaborate, and the tests that are used to look for new physics require ever greater precision. To say something new about the Standard Model, it is no longer sufficient to be an expert. One must now be an expert even within the community of experts. The other direction has been towards deep exploration in the empty quarter of theory space. The direct empirical motivation for many of these peregrinations is somewhere between marginal and non-existent. There is little or no attempt to use these wanderings either to explain current experimental anomalies or to make predictions for experiments on a near-future timescale. It involves theoretical structures that are inspired by those that are observationally relevant, but the inspiration may be loose. The aim is to understand these theoretical, perhaps quasi-mathematical, structures and to grasp their inner mechanics. Such theories may either never be applicable to nature or may only apply at energy scales reaching far beyond those accessible in current particle colliders. The close connection between advances in theory and advances in experiment is put aside in favor of the deep study of theories for their own sake, with mathematics rather than experiment as the closest companion in the attempt to advance the subject. One of the best-known finds from these journeys is the subject of this book, string theory. Over a period of almost 50 years from its origins in 1968, string theory has spread from nothing to become a major component of theoretical particle physics. In terms of money, theoretical physics is not a big subject. It is a flea-bite on experimental particle physics, which is itself a flea-bite compared to medical research, which is in turn a flea-bite on the totality of government spending. Yet intellectually, particle theory has always punched far above its financial weight. Its topic is the basic laws governing our universe, and interest in these laws extends far beyond the confines of those who are salaried to think about them. Theoretical physics has provided, certainly not all, but definitely one part, of the answer to the universal questions of who we are and where we come from. It is also simply true that within particle theory, string theory is a big subject. There are few large particle theory groups within major universities that do not have at least one person doing string theory. In total, there are probably a couple of thousand people at universities around the world whose mortgage is paid by either doing string theory, using string theory, working with tools made within string theory, solving problems using methods developed in string theory, or simply having their mental map of the world at the smallest possible scales set by string theory. String theory is most famous as a theory of quantum gravity and a candidate theory of fundamental interactions at the smallest possible scales, scales that are as small compared to an atomic nucleus as an atomic nucleus is to a person. These scales are also far smaller than can be directly probed by any experiment, even the Large Hadron Collider at CERN. This raises a natural question. If you cannot test string theory directly, how do you know it is right? And if you do not know it is right, and you will not know any time soon, why do so many people work on it? Surely science advances by experiment, and without experiment, there can be nothing but stagnation. This is a question posed by many decent, smart, and inquisitive people. They may be undergraduate students of physics. They may be evolutionary biologists. They may be observational astronomers. They may be intellectually curious members of the general public who are excited about the fundamental laws of physics. Those who ask this question are people of good will and good faith, who in all charity cannot understand how any one scientific idea without direct experimental support could ever command the time and allegiance of such a large fraction of the relevant experts. For it is true that the closer you approach the subject professionally, the fewer and fewer people you find who continue to ask these questions. Skepticism about string theory tends to diminish as technical knowledge about the subject increases. In practice, the hard acid that dissolves skepticism is the ability to calculate. The greater the ability to calculate in theoretical physics, the clearer the appeal of string theory becomes, both for its own intrinsic, perfectly fitting calculational structure, and also for its ability to shed light on results in other areas. However, it is also true that in return for this ability to calculate, one must pay dearly in terms of time, effort, and earning ability. Most people, however strong their interest or aptitude, are for perfectly good reasons not able to follow this route. This book is written for these people and aims to answer these questions. I want to explain to my wonderful fellow citizens who support scientific research through their taxes why string theory is so popular and why, despite the lack of direct empirical support, it has attained the level of prominence it has. I want to explain how string theory fits into the broader picture of science and just why experts find it so compelling. If all the varied rationales of this book were condensed into one single aim, it is to answer the question, why do so many experts choose to work on a theory that has no direct experimental support? My dear colleagues know the answer already, but this book is not written for them. This is also, for obvious reasons, a book almost without equations. There exists an opinion that if you have true understanding, equations are unnecessary and you can convey concepts with no losses in transmission. I do not share this view. Mathematics is the light that illuminates physics, and mathematics-free physics has marked similarities to alcohol-free wine. Mathematics is the most powerful tool available for explaining and understanding physics, being to a physicist what fingers are to a pianist. Nature really is written in the language of mathematics, and many results that flow easily using it are hard to justify in any other way. In this subject, mathematical training is a pure and unqualified good. There is no additional raw creative freshness available through its absence. So, I apologize now for the fact that the argument made in this book is only a shadow of the argument I would like to make. I'm also sorry, despite my best efforts, for the parts of this book that appear less than clear, or where the logical jumps seem broad and unjustified. That said, that which is worth doing is also worth doing poorly. One does not need the palate of Carême to enjoy food, or the ear of Barenboim to listen to music. The rose windows of Chartres are both for those who can follow the biblical stories there and for those who cannot. And the great structure of physics, at least in its outline, is part of the inheritance of all interested minds. I now want to describe the structure of the book and the overall organization of its argument. The first part of the book aims to place string theory, the theory of quantum mechanical relativistic strings, within the broader context of both science as a whole, and more specifically, theoretical particle physics. There is a lot of science, most of science, indeed almost all of science, that has nothing to do with either the fundamental laws of nature or the discovery of new physical principles. My first aim is to isolate the small part of science for which string theory is potentially relevant, and then to describe the important truths that are already known in this area. These topics are covered in chapters 2 and 3. Chapter 2 deals with science as a whole, classifying it by the different length scales that are appropriate. Chapter 3 focuses specifically on physics and on the confirmed results that have been used to build up the modern picture of both particle physics and cosmology. Whatever string theory may be, it is certainly outside the canon of established and experimentally confirmed theories. Why do we even need anything new at all? Chapter 4 makes the case for this. It argues that what we have is not enough. Despite all previous successes, there is still a need for ideas and structures that go beyond what we already have. When we look at what we have learned, we see that indeed it is very good, but it does not suffice. Chapter 4 makes no argument for string theory as such. It instead argues for something new. It argues that there must exist something that is not included in our existing theories, but instead sits above and beyond them. It explains why theory, observation, and experiment all demand that what we currently know is not ultimately at the top of the intellectual food chain. We are still missing a Godzilla theory that is the top predator. String theory is, in the first instance, a candidate for that something. It is introduced in the second part of the book, and is the subject of chapters 5 and 6. These are devoted to explaining first what string theory was, and then what string theory is. what do the words string theory actually refer to? What does the expression string theory even mean? This is a simple question with a complicated answer that has changed dramatically over the last 50 years. What string theory meant in 1970 was not what it meant in 1985, which in turn was not what it meant in 2000. Likewise, the motivations for working on the subject have also changed over these periods. The reason for first studying string theory in 1970 was a very bad reason for studying string theory in 1985, but had returned to be one of the most common reasons in 2010. While the underlying equations and calculations have undergone a mostly smooth development, the conceptual picture of what string theory is and how it fits into physics has changed dramatically. These chapters are therefore both explanatory and historical. To appreciate what string theory means in 2015, it is helpful to know what string theory had previously meant in both 1970 and 1985. Over this period, the history of string theory interleaves with the history of particle physics. Chapter 5 is concerned with past understandings of string theory, while Chapter 6 presents a more current view. Having reviewed the history and nature of string theory, the third part of the book describes motivations for doing research on it. Chapter 7 is devoted to the external correctness of string theory. It reviews the direct experimental evidence proving that string theory is the correct theory of nature at the smallest possible scales. The four chapters after that explore several particular topics in further depth. The essence of these chapters is that scientists work on string theory because string theory is useful to them. The human foibles of scientists are often appreciated more in the abstract than in the reality. Scientists have their own pet topics, and they care most about what will assist them in their own passions. One of the dirty great secrets about string theory, the candidate fundamental theory of everything, is that the majority of people who work on this subject actually care little for strings per se, and absolutely nothing for fundamental theories of everything. Instead, they have their own interests, which are generally not formulated in terms of string theory, and they care about string theory because it can help them understand what they are actually interested in. The third part of the book describes this in detail and explains why people really choose to work on string theory. Chapter 8 is on quantum field theory. We do not know whether string theory is the correct theory of nature. We do, however, know that the standard model is a correct theory of nature, and the standard model is built up by describing the strong, weak, and electromagnetic forces through what is called a quantum field theory. Quantum field theories are a known part of nature, and they are used not just in particle physics, but also in the physics of matter, to describe the way quantum behavior manifests itself in macroscopic bodies such as insulators or conductors, both semi and super. This ubiquity of quantum field theory causes many physicists to be interested in understanding it better. They care both about special examples where a quantum field theory can be solved exactly, and also about general insights into how to understand and work with quantum field theories in regimes where all normal techniques break down. Indeed, probably the most popular reason to work on string theory in the years since the millennium has been for the help it provides in understanding quantum field theory. Another reason for working on string theory, covered in Chapter 9, stems from an interest in mathematics. The developmental logic of string theory was that of physics. It has been constructed by physicists using the techniques and standards that apply in theoretical physics. Nonetheless, it involves geometric ideas, and the subject has many overlaps with topics of interest to mathematicians. This creates a fortunate situation. It offers a perspective that is removed enough to be novel, but close enough to be useful. The logic of physics is different to that of mathematics, and what is obvious in physics is not obvious in mathematics, enabling the discovery of results that are both new and striking. Since the middle of the 1980s, string theory has acted as tinder for the historic romance of physics with mathematics, provoking both new mathematical techniques and new approaches to existing problems. Of course, many people who work on string theory, including me, do so because they are fascinated by particle physics and cosmology and want to know what lies beyond our existing boundaries of knowledge. This is the topic of Chapter 10. String theory provides a rich structure that links on to what we already know about physics, while also offering many suggestions for what may lie beyond. While it is implausible to claim that string theory offers any unique extension of the standard models of particle physics and cosmology, it provides plentiful examples of types of new physics that one would not otherwise think about. In this respect, string theory is a fine muse and a fertile source of ideas for new ways of thinking about new physics. String theory may not easily be definitively tested, but it is a good source of ideas that can be. These ideas then enter the conventional process by which experiments can be proposed and built to check their veracity. Chapter 11 deals with string theory as a theory of quantum gravity. This is the headline application of the subject, and has indeed seen a significant amount of work over the years. The chapter describes both the reasons for believing that string theory offers a quantum description of the gravitational force, as well as specific applications to some of the classic problems of classical and quantum gravity. The fourth and final part of the book discusses the social aspects of science. The public view of string theory and string theorists has fluctuated over time. One perspective has seen string theorists as the intellectual equivalents of John Wayne, using the power of pure thought to conquer the untamed territories of physics. A more recent outlook sees them as surrender monkeys who inherited the great tradition of theoretical physics and fled from experiment for a combination of mathematical arcana and personal wonga. I hope to show that the truth is more human than the first, and richer and more powerful than the second. One of the overarching themes of the book is that of diversity. Different scientists care about very different topics, and there are as many approaches to physics as there are physicists. Jeffrey Boycott and Kevin Peterson were both excellent cricketers who garnered a sackful of runs, despite having personalities and playing styles that could not have been more different. The same holds true in physics. Some prefer deep and intricate calculations with a clear right answer that emerges only after many pages of precise and exact work. Others prefer drawing big picture connections between disparate areas with no apparent relation. Some are only happy when working in close tandem with experiment, while others find satisfaction in the pristine purity of mathematics and are repulsed by the dirtiness of data. There are many ways to be a first-rate physicist, and no one choice is best. Chapter 12 is devoted to pen portraits of some of these different styles of doing physics. Chapter 13 considers criticisms of string theory. String theory is discussed in fora that reach far beyond the circles of theoretical physics, and it is a tribute to the culture and education of our society that many people care about aspects of fundamental physics so removed from their daily lives. In the same way that honest and engaged citizens can have markedly opposed political views, attitudes to string theory vary sharply, and some scientists are passionately concerned that string theory is damaging physics. This chapter aims to take these attacks, frame them in their most convincing form, and reply to them. The final chapter summarizes the overall message of this book. Why is string theory so appealing? There are other speculative theories of physics at the smallest possible scales. This chapter explains why string theory has been so much more successful than them. What makes string theory special? The short answer is that, in contrast to other approaches, string theory is so much more than just a candidate theory of quantum gravity. Other theories of quantum gravity are precisely that, other theories of quantum gravity. In contrast, string theory is a theory for the pragmatic as well as for the ideological. It has outgrown its origins and has something to offer those who are completely uninterested in quantum gravity. Its success in solving problems and contributing deep insights to so many topics has made it popular with many. The same deep insights, far away from its native subject, also convince many that it is the most plausible idea on its home ground. String theory has given much to many, and its enduring popularity comes from the fact that, over several decades, it has remained a theory that just keeps on giving. Chapter 2. Scales of Science, Little and Large. As-salamu alaykum. From where are you coming, and to where do you go? the ancient call of the desert, from caravan to caravan as they passed on the spice road, also applies to science. A subject with no past can lack the techniques necessary to do science. A subject with no idea as to the problems it is trying to solve has no future. This is a book about string theory. Where does string theory fit into the larger canvas of science and physics? Science is a big tent with many tent dwellers. Its discoveries have been the primary facilitator of the enormous economic growth of the last few centuries, and few politicians fail to pay at least lip service to it. In the United Kingdom, the annual government budget for science is around £10 billion, although the overall sum spent is slightly larger because of charitable funding of medical research and the industrial research done in large pharmaceutical and engineering companies. In this big friendly tent, where does string theory fit in? The short answer is, not where the money is. In the most recent academic year, string theory research received somewhere south of 0.1% of total science funding in the United Kingdom. In the affairs of pounds, shillings, and pence, string theory is a tiny tiddler, even within a relatively small pond. Cost represents one way of classifying different branches of science. Another more subjective measure is by practical utility. String theory belongs clearly to those branches of science that are the canaries in the coal mine for curiosity-driven research. These branches are pursued for the value of intrinsic understanding rather than for any vision of commercial application. As with astronomy or particle physics, string theory is clearly pure rather than applied science. It is true that the pure science of one generation has tended to become the applied science of the next. The quantum theory of the electron underpins the semiconductors and transistors that sit behind all modern electronics. The accuracy of a GPS device relies on Einstein's laws of general relativity. Proton therapy, the poster child of advanced cancer treatments, is applied particle physics. However, whatever the unknown future may be, it is important to be clear up front that there are no currently foreseeable economic applications for string theory. We will arrange our scientific taxonomy differently, classifying sciences according to their characteristic distance scales, the size of the phenomena they study. Characteristic is a woolly word that is nonetheless more useful than an overly exact definition. Its usage is best illustrated by example. The characteristic size of a blade of grass is a couple of centimeters. The characteristic size of a mountain is a couple of kilometers. The characteristic size of a galaxy is 100,000 light years. We are all human. Excepting hobbits and point guards, an adult member of Homo sapiens is typically between 150 and 190 centimeters tall. He or she is made predominantly of water and weighs between 45 and 90 kilograms. These basic facts determine our first scientific, or rather proto-scientific, intuitions. Our growing lives are conditioned by and organized around the effects of gravity. Children learn at an early age that they cannot walk up walls, and that if they fall over, they hurt themselves. These natural effects are natural only due to our characteristic size. Intelligent ants would experience the world very differently. Gravity is far harder to discover if you can walk up a wall without difficulty and fall down a mine shaft without danger. There is not that much ant for gravity to act on, and it is surface tension rather than gravity that plays the crucial role in daily myrmecological life. We are all human. We measure distances in meters and time in seconds. It is not a coincidence that the acceleration due to gravity, measured in these units, has a numerical value of 10 meters per second per second, not 1,000 and not 1,000th. Meters and seconds are units that are adapted to us, which is why our most familiar force is characterized by a number not too different from 1 when measured in these units. From our own scales, there are two ways to go: up and up, or down and down. As we go up, we increase the distance scale. The meter becomes the kilometer, and we step beyond the scales of living organisms. These scales belong to geography and geology, and they are associated with a profound, if prehistoric, discovery: the Earth is not flat, but round. The evidence for this is simple, As ships sail to distant ports, they disappear beyond sight over the horizon. First, the body of the ship disappears, and finally the masts. This effect is due to the curvature of the Earth. Attempting to see a distant ship is like attempting to see over a hill. From the distance at which a ship disappears, it is possible to estimate the radius of the Earth. Indeed, already in the 3rd century BC, the Greek scholar Eratosthenes, using a different method, made an accurate measurement of the diameter of the Earth. The sphericity and size of the Earth is the first major result in astronomy. Islands, countries, and seas have distant scales ranging from kilometers to thousands of kilometers, and it is these scales that are used to characterize the geography of Earth. For example, the distance to the center of the Earth is around 6,000 kilometers, and the tectonic plates on which the surface of the Earth is supported are thousands of kilometers across. Larger distances are not elegantly described in terms of kilometers. The distance from the Earth to the Moon is around 380,000 kilometers. The distance from the Earth to the Sun is around 150 million kilometers, while the distance to the next star is around 40,000 billion kilometers. The numbers become clunky and do nothing to develop intuition. There is a more natural kind of unit, light units. These involve the distances traveled by light in either seconds, minutes, or years. Light travels at approximately 300,000 kilometers a second. One light second corresponds to a distance of 300,000 kilometers, while one light year corresponds to a little over 4,000 billion kilometers. Within the solar system, the Sun is a mere 8 light minutes from Earth, and the Earth just over 1 light second from the Moon. The planetary denizens of the solar system, Uranus, Mars, Venus, and Jupiter, took their names from the Roman deities. Now they are simply the domestic avatars of planetary science. The next step is from one star to many. As light minutes become light years, we move from our own Sun to all other stars, and the scale of the galaxy is reached. Galaxies are a collection of stars, some very much like the Sun and others less so. This collection numbers around 100 billion stars in total. These all circle an enormously heavy black hole at the center of the galaxy, in the same way that the planets circle our Sun. The size of our galaxy is such that it takes light around 100,000 years to cross it, and such that a galactic year, the time taken for the Sun to rotate around the galaxy back to its current location, is 225 million years. By now, these distance scales, the scales of galactic astronomy, are so large that we have no real human conception of them. We can state them, we can calculate with them, but we cannot feel them. For one science, even this distance is parochial. That science is cosmology, the study of the whole universe. A cosmologist asked to discuss galactic dynamics is like a national politician asked about the church fate. The event is rather parochial for those with eyes on grander matters. Cosmologists concern themselves not with thousands of light years, but billions, and not with single galaxies, but the statistical properties of thousands. How far apart are galaxies on average, and how do they cluster together? Coming up from human scales, the scales attained in cosmology represent the largest distances in science. There are no bigger scales known, and we literally cannot see any further. There is a finite amount of time since the Big Bang, and in this period light has only had the opportunity to travel a certain finite, albeit large, distance. Light is what we can see, and light travels further and faster than anything else. This ends the upwards journey. Before asking where string theory fits in, we also want to trace distances downwards, from the scales of humans down to the smallest known scales. It turns out, surprisingly, that the science of the very largest distances is closely related to the science of the very smallest. As for the far left and far right in politics, the principles that apply at the extremes turn out to be remarkably similar to one another. We started the upwards journey on the human scale, the scale of meters, and we return here for the downwards journey. This scale is shared by other large mammals and is the largest of the biological scales. Even the biggest of the dinosaurs was never more than tens of meters in length. The reason for this is gravity, The bigger you are, the more energy is required to move muscles against gravity. The largest mammal today is the blue whale, which only achieves its size by mitigating these effects through the buoyancy of a watery home. The large animals are merely the most biologically visible, sitting at the top of the digestive ladder of who eats whom. As we come down in distances by a factor of 100, we start measuring lengths in centimeters and millimeters. This is still the scale of biology, but it is the scale of a different kind of biology. Ants and other insects live here. Why is this a different kind of biology? This is because, as mentioned before, clever ants and clever insects would develop science in a very different order to us. They experience the world differently, and the differences are entirely due to size. Where horses can only splash, insects such as pond skaters can actually walk on water. This is so because they are small enough that the surface tension of water can dominate the effects of gravity. Unlike elephants, small insects can be picked up and blown away in the wind, and they can fall great distances without harm. An ant weighs 1/100 of a gram, and a human 100 kilograms. The gravitational force on an ant is almost 1 billion times weaker than that on a human, and gravity plays a proportionately smaller part in the entomological environment. Ants and other insects do, however, have eyes, which they use to navigate their world. The next step on our descent is to the largest end of the so-called mesoscopic scale, involving distances comparable to 1 micrometer, 1,000 times smaller than a millimeter. 1 micrometer is approximately twice the size of the wavelength of visible light. Distances smaller than this cannot, even in principle, be resolved using ordinary light. It would be like attempting to make filigree lace whilst wearing boxing gloves. This scale is the end boundary of biology, inhabited by the smallest living organisms. A single cell is around 10 micrometers across, and a single virus around 1/5 of a micrometer in length. The mesoscopic scale extends down to tens of nanometers. The mesoscale is also the scale of the physics of polymers and liquid crystals. The physics of these distances is one where gravity is entirely negligible, and all forces and interactions arise from electromagnetic effects and the distribution of electric charge. It is at this scale that the fictional forces, such as friction, are seen to originate from interactions between the surfaces of two bodies. I use the expression fictional not because friction does not exist, but because it does not have an independent existence. Friction is a macroscopic name given to the effects of microscopic interactions. These electromagnetic interactions are remarkably strong. One of the easiest ways to understand this is to note that in a sitting position, the downwards gravitational pull of the entire Earth, all 1,000 billion billion tons of it, on the bottom, is defeated by the short-range electromagnetic effects between the chair and the derriere. While these short-range forces are known by many names, stress, strain, normal reaction, and friction, each one of these only serves to capture a different macroscopic aspect of the electromagnetic forces of the mesoscale. As we pass through the mesoscale, we cross the great Rubicon of physics. We start with distances described using classical physics, for which there is no need to introduce quantum mechanics. We end with distances for which there is no longer a good classical description. The world is quantum and irrevocably quantum. This marks a radical change in how we can think about physics, as an object can no longer have both a well-defined location and a well-defined speed. Quantum mechanics is subsequently needed at all distance scales smaller than this, and it is never again absent from the equations. The next big step down is to the nanoscale at 1/1,000,000,000 of a meter. Once at the nanoscale, the truth that the world is quantum and not classical is undeniable and encountered everywhere. The nanoscale is also the scale of atoms. On one level, atoms are tiny. They were traditionally viewed as the fundamental building blocks of matter, and their name comes from the Greek for indivisible, atomos. Atoms are also at a scale so far removed from everyday life that the existence of atoms was not established until the 19th century. Size is, however, relative, and the atomic scale is simply a staging post on our continuing journey. It is easy to think that as atoms are small, everything within them is equally small. This is not so. Atoms consist of electrons with negative electric charge orbiting a tiny central nucleus which has positive electric charge and consists of protons and neutrons. One of the greatest of all conceptual realignments in science was the discovery that the periodic table of elements and their properties follows entirely from quantum mechanics applied to protons, neutrons, and electrons. The hydrogen atom is the quantum mechanical solution of the system of an electron and a proton. The helium atom is the quantum mechanical solution of the system of two electrons around a nucleus consisting of two protons and two neutrons. The scale of atoms is the scale of chemistry, the science that studies the combination of atoms to form molecules, and the subsequent interactions between atoms, molecules, and other molecules. Chemistry is just applied quantum mechanics. The chemical bond is a name that describes the effects of the solutions of quantum mechanics. In the hydrogen atom, the proton is a minute central ball of charge, while the electron is diffused throughout the atom. Quantum mechanically, the electron is everywhere. The nucleus, even quantum mechanically, is confined in a tiny central region. Tiny here really does mean tiny. To get a sense of the relative scales, if the hydrogen atom as a whole were blown up to the size of a mountain, the central nucleus would still only be the size of a light bulb. The laws of quantum mechanics govern the diffuse, probabilistic motion of the electron around this central light bulb. What happens within it? The laws of quantum mechanics also govern the far more complicated internal behavior of the light bulb. The step from the scale of the atom to the scale of the nucleus brings us to the scales of nuclear physics. Nuclear physics is a science with a glorious infancy in the 1930s and 1940s, a happy maturity in the 50s and 60s, and a long gradual decline since then. The atomic nuclei are made of some number of protons and some number of neutrons. There are many different nuclei, which can be enumerated as a botanist enumerates flowers. These different types of nuclei directly give the diversity of chemical elements. The distinct chemical elements directly correspond to the different numbers of protons that a nucleus can have. The interactions between atoms are determined by physics at the scale of the atom. The distinct types of atom are determined by physics at the scale of the nucleus. Nuclear physics blossomed as a subject in the 1930s, when it was understood that nuclei of one type could turn into nuclei of another type. This could occur through occasional random processes, radioactive decay of either alpha or beta kind, as first identified by Marie and Pierre Curie. It could also occur through human intervention. It thus became apparent that the base metals were not immutable, and the philosopher's stone that had been sought for millennia was realized as a focused beam of particles powered by a Cockcroft-Walton accelerator. It was also clear that a deeper layer of physics underlay the changes between the different nuclei. This deeper layer of physics remained mysterious for a long time. Nuclei made of protons and neutrons were known not to be fundamental objects. Complex nuclei consist of large numbers of both protons and neutrons. A typical nucleus of gold contains 79 protons and 118 neutrons. Atoms and their nuclei therefore joined earth, air, fire, and water as non-elemental objects that, on close examination, fall to bits. However, even single protons or neutrons are composite rather than elementary objects. A free neutron, left to itself, will decay on an average timescale of 15 minutes, leaving a proton behind. If a proton is hit hard enough with another particle, it will also break apart. Protons and neutrons, each with a radius of around 1 femtometer, 1 millionth of a nanometer, are the smallest known composite objects in the universe. The science that deals with distances smaller than this is particle physics. This science describes elementary particles such as the electron, and also the quarks that make up the proton and neutron. There are three quarks required for both a proton and a neutron, held together by the strong force. The name quark is an odd one and comes from a literary indulgence. Originally called aces, the human encyclopedia and Nobel laureate Murray Gell-Mann gave them the name that stuck after a word from James Joyce's Finnegan's Wake, As far as is known, the quarks join the electron as elementary particles with no further substructure. Particle physics is, as it says on the tin, about the physics of particles. At its most basic level, it involves enumerating the known particles, searching for new ones, and determining the laws and rules that govern their interactions. Enumeration and classification is by itself no more than taxonomy. The real thrust of the subject, capable of waking its practitioners in the night, lies in the search for the deep truths that organize hundreds and thousands of different observations and measurements into different facets of a single beautiful idea. Particle physics may appear complex, but at heart it is a simple subject for simple minds. It is a simple subject, but not an easy one. Its simplicity is of the kind that lies on the far side of difficulty, confusion, and complexity. The journey is difficult, but the view, once achieved, is magnificent. The known range of particle physics extends down to around 1/10,000th of the size of the nucleus. It has achieved this by first accelerating particles to high energies and then colliding them. The larger the energy, the smaller the distance scales probed. The most energetic collider in the world is the Large Hadron Collider at CERN, outside Geneva, which sets the current experimental frontier. In a completion of the upwards and downwards journeys, it turns out that physics at these very smallest scales is also crucial for cosmology, and in particular for the distribution of matter throughout the visible universe. In a sense that is not totally inaccurate, the Large Hadron Collider can be said to recreate the conditions that held in the very earliest epoch of the universe. I have described the sciences of many different scales. These are all scales on which experiments can be carried out, and almost all of science is contained within one of these scales. String theory is not the science of any of the above distant scales. It is directly relevant for the more hypothetical regions where one asks, what happens as distances get smaller and smaller? This is a real part of nature, but not a part where it is currently possible to do experiments. It involves extrapolating from what we know to be true to what might be true. What are the laws of nature that apply at these shorter distance scales? At the smaller scales we can measure, particle physics tells us that the laws of nature are described by the combination of quantum mechanics and special relativity. The only consistent way of combining these is through what is called quantum field theory. We first ask, can these techniques apply down to arbitrarily small distances? We know that all previous laws of physics have either broken down or required modification as they have been pushed to smaller distances. Nonetheless, if the experimentally confirmed ideas of particle physics would all also work there, Occam's razor, the statement that entities should not be multiplied without necessity, could be taken to suggest that there is no pressing need to investigate radically new ideas. One motivation for string theory, and one reason why this book exists, is that we know that this is not true. What has worked so far must fail at sufficiently short distances. In fact, the theories that we currently have signal their own demise. As we move continually down in size, there is a distance by which this failure must become manifest, a gaping and obvious hole in our attempts to understand nature. This distance is called the Planck length. This distance is genuinely tiny, 1 billion billion times smaller than the typical radius of the nucleus. It is as small compared to a nucleus as an atom is compared to the Earth. This distance is nonetheless finite, and is a distance scale by which we know that our knowledge of physics must break down. Why must current physics fail? We shall return to this in more detail in the next two chapters. Here, let me say that particle physics describes quantum particles in a classical space-time. Space-time is the fixed classical background against which the quantum interactions of particles take place. However, Einstein taught us that space-time is actually not fixed. Space-time interacts both with particles and with itself. The fully sophisticated version of this is general relativity, for which Newtonian gravity is, for almost all purposes, a good approximation. The approximation of fixed space-time is equivalent to neglecting the effects of gravity. For most purposes in particle physics, this works wonderfully, because gravity as a force is so weak, using only my hands I can pull myself up, and defeat the gravitational pull of the entire Earth. The Planck length is defined as the distance scale at which this approximation must finally fail. At these scales, the effects of gravity can no longer be neglected, and the quantum theories of the electromagnetic, strong, and weak forces must be joined by a quantum theory of the gravitational force. There is also an important point to make about the Planck length. The Planck length tells us the smallest possible length that the theories we know and love could be correct down to. It does not tell us the length at which these theories actually do break down. It is entirely possible that these theories fail on lengths considerably larger than the Planck length. While everyone agrees that what we know must fail by the time we have reached the Planck length, no one knows exactly where, between the scales we have probed experimentally and the Planck length, the great engine of known physics judders to a halt. A theory of the Planck scale requires a correct quantum mechanical description of gravity. Obtaining a definitively correct quantum theory of gravity is possibly the biggest open problem in theoretical physics. Cometh the hour, cometh the solution, and cometh another, and another, and another. Just as national crises see more than one politician volunteering themselves as the savior of the country, so the important and well-posed nature of the quantum gravity problem sees many ideas put forward as proposed solutions. However, something new must come in at the Planck scale. What will that something be? Modern theoretical physics says, if not by unanimous agreement, then at least by a large majority, that something is most likely to be string theory. String theory states that somewhere between the scales of the Large Hadron Collider and the Planck scale, new degrees of freedom will come in, and those degrees of freedom will be the higher harmonics of vibrating strings. It should be said here that consensus opinions are dangerous things. There is a consensus opinion that the world is not flat, but there also used to be consensus opinions that smoking did not cause health problems, and that there was no need to sterilize medical equipment between separate operations. Consensus opinions about the Planck scale deserve a heightened level of scrutiny because of the great difficulties in evaluating any such ideas experimentally. The simplest way to describe string theory, then, is as one candidate solution of the quantum gravity problem, and so as a candidate theory of physics at the smallest possible length scales. As the book will show, this is a rather limiting definition of the subject. If all string theory had to offer was a possible idea for quantum gravity, it would receive far less attention than it does. However, that argument is one I intend to develop over the rest of the book, at the same time showing that the consensus opinion about the importance of string theory is held for good reasons. The purpose of this chapter has been to locate string theory within the scientific vista. In this picture, its natural home is among the physics of the smallest possible scales. The ultimate story is richer, and we will later see surprising connections to physics at much larger distance scales. But this is where string theory has arisen from. The techniques it uses are most closely related to those of particle physics, with which it shares much of its language and personnel. Before narrowing down onto string theory, however, I want to first review some of the great truths of physics. Chapter 3. Big Lessons of Physics. Space and time are cut from the same cloth. In the beginning, history, culture, and religion, as in the first words of the Bible, reflect a classical notion of time that is easy to understand and appears obviously correct. This notion says that there exists one universal time that applies everywhere and to everyone. It has counted from the beginning to now, and it counts from now to the future. The lives and fortunes of mice and men are marked out by the beat of a celestial gong. This view was expressed by Isaac Newton in the Principia, the work describing his laws of motion. Absolute, true, and mathematical time, of itself, and from its own nature, flows equably without relation to anything external, and by another name is called duration. Relative, apparent, and common time is some sensible and external, whether accurate or unequable, measure of duration by the means of motion, which is commonly used instead of true time, such as an hour, a day, a month, a year. According to this view, we could in principle synchronize our watches with distant aliens visiting from a far-off galaxy. The aliens could return to their home galaxy, stay there for many years, and then once again come to Earth. On their arrival, we could compare our watches once more, and we would find them to be still identical. In this picture, time sits above and apart from space, acting as a universal coordinate labeling events in space. This notion of time is so ingrained in us that it took a very special person to realize that it is, in fact, wrong. That person was Albert Einstein, and the realization occurred in 1905 with the development of special relativity. Special relativity is sometimes crudely described as the addition of a fourth dimension, with that dimension being time. If this were all special relativity was, Einstein would not have gone beyond the inheritance of Newton. Special relativity is instead built around two crucial insights, one conceptual and one technical. The former generates a philosophical revolution, the latter a calculational one. The conceptual insight is that space and time are knit from the same cloth. There is not, contra Newton, any division into absolute space and absolute time, with separation in space and separation in time being two entirely disjoint concepts. In relativity, this division is not absolute, but varies from observer to observer. I, stationary in my armchair of reflection, may see two events as simultaneous and with a purely spatial separation. You, passing by on a bicycle, or more realistically, a spaceship travelling close to the speed of light, would instead see one event as clearly earlier than the other. This insight does not imply that time has no meaning. One of the most important roles of time is to mark causation, and to say what was before and what was after. The sequence of causation remains unaltered in relativity. Some events cause other events, and must always precede them. Whoever you are, you will agree that the event, my son Alexander was born, came later in time than the event, I was born. The former could not have occurred without the latter. However, different observers may disagree on whether the event, I was born, comes before or after the event, the alien Zach on the planet Zorg was born. The second great insight is more technical in nature. It was already known that the laws of physics do not depend on where you are or which direction you're looking in. Experiments in Madrid, Mumbai, and Moscow get the same results, and the laws of physics do not care whether experiments are located in a north-facing building or a south-facing building. There can be local environmental effects. June in Madrid and December in Moscow require different levels of thermal insulation. However, once these environmental effects are removed, the underlying laws of physics have no preferred orientation, as the three spatial directions can be rotated into one another without changing the laws of physics. Einstein also realized that these rotations can be extended to include the time direction. There is a particular set of rotations that mix the space and time coordinates under which the laws of physics are invariant. This rotation is called a Lorentz transformation, and underlies all the mathematics of both special and general relativity. It is not the purpose of this book to give a detailed treatise on relativity or to describe its mathematics. The essence of relativity was neither the mutual identification nor the abolition of space and time, but instead the realization that they are both cut from the same cloth and are part of a single object, space-time. In the words of one of the founders of relativity, the German physicist Hermann Minkowski, space of itself and time of itself will disappear into mere shadows, and only a kind of union between the two will survive. Space-time is dynamical. Special relativity took Newton's vision of absolute space and absolute time and destroyed it. Physics, according to Newton, involved events in space occurring to the backdrop of a universal time measured on a divine clock. This vision vanished with special relativity, and Newton's concept of absolute time died a complete and irreversible death. As the arena in which the laws of physics played out, space and time were replaced in special relativity by the single object space-time. This new entity then became the unchangeable background against which the laws of physics are formulated. This insight belonged to Einstein. It is to his great credit that he also made the further discovery that the new picture is also wrong. Special relativity must in turn be replaced by general relativity. General relativity, which Einstein developed in 1915, takes the immutable space-time of special relativity and breathes life into it. The single most important point of general relativity is that space-time itself is dynamical. The geometry of space-time evolves in response to matter. Matter tells geometry how to bend, and geometry tells matter how to move. The fixed space-time of special relativity is revealed to be no more fixed than the fixed stars of Ptolemaic astronomy. The details of exactly how geometry responds to matter and how matter responds to geometry lie within the equations of general relativity. Superficially, these equations are highly complex. There are 10 of them, and they all depend on each other and have to be treated at the same time. For all but the very simplest cases, they are hard to solve exactly. However, properly understood, these equations describe one of the most conceptually simple of all scientific ideas. The gravitational response of matter to geometry in the curved space-time of general relativity is extremely easy to state. Matter always continues in the direction it is already going, following the shortest, straightest path it can find. What could be simpler? Aircraft flight paths, which appear as funny curves on two-dimensional projections of the Earth, become straight lines when viewed on an actual globe. In curved space-times, this principle of shortness and straightness already encompasses all the motion of bodies in Newtonian gravity. Within general relativity, the inverse square force law of Newton's law of gravity is simply a consequence of the statement that bodies travel in straight lines in curved space-time. General relativity is the paradigmatic example of good theoretical physics. It is mathematically beautiful and elegant. It is conceptually simple, with no free parameters and no adjustable knobs that need tuning. It is also physically true and gives a precise description of many aspects of the universe. Its scientific virtues are completed by the fact that it is also practically useful, being essential for the correct functioning of GPS devices. That space-time is dynamical and the geometry of the universe itself is evolving is also the foundation of modern cosmology. As we will discuss further, observations of distant galaxies require for consistency that as time goes on, the space between the galaxies must be increasing. As time goes on, there is simply more space between the galaxies than there used to be. The overall geometry has changed, and space itself has stretched. We give a one-dimensional analogy for this expansion. We consider two small ants on an elastic band. To start with, the band is unstretched, and the ants can walk around the band from one to another. We can imagine them as separated by a particular finite distance, say 5 centimeters, such that if one ant wanted to walk across to its friend, it would take a particular time, for example, 10 seconds. We now gradually start pulling the band so that it stretches. As we do so, the separation between the ants increases. Neither ant has moved by themselves, as they have in no way exerted themselves. However, as we continue pulling on the band, the ants progressively move further and further apart. The amount of time it would take one ant to travel to the other also grows, from 10 seconds to 30 seconds, to 5 minutes and more. The intermediate space has grown and expanded, and its geometry has changed. In this example, the change in the geometry of the band is imposed by an external agent, the person pulling on its ends. The band does not stretch dynamically by itself, but only through applied external forces. In general relativity applied to cosmology, the growth of the universe and the change in its geometry is dynamical. It is determined entirely by the sources of matter and energy within the universe. The dynamical nature of space-time is also crucial to the existence of black holes. In normal circumstances, the curvature of space is small. Regular matter, the Earth or even the Sun, produces only small local distortions on a flat background space-time. Why do I say small? In physics, small and large are always relative concepts. The Sun's gravitational force may be large by human standards, but it is perfectly described by Newton's theory of gravitation, and small in this context means well described by Newton. The sun is neither sufficiently dense nor sufficiently massive to affect space-time. As an analogue for these distortions, imagine a tennis ball placed on a tight trampoline. The trampoline bends slightly, but retains its shape. However, if enough matter is put into a small enough region, these distortions are no longer small. The analogy is no longer a tennis ball on a trampoline, but a beach ball filled with concrete. Space-time is no longer similar, but slightly curved, but bends in on itself beyond the point of return. Given enough matter, space-time curves so much and so badly that it produces a region from which nothing can escape, a black hole. Black holes are a consequence of the dynamics of space-time. Space-time curves in response to matter, and if enough matter is present, space-time curves enough to form a black hole. The densities required are large. A black hole with the mass of the Earth would require all its matter to be squashed into a region 9 millimeters in radius. The squash radius grows linearly with the mass. The Sun, 150,000 times heavier than Earth, would need to be compressed into a region around 3 kilometers in radius, which is indeed the typical size of the black holes that are formed as an endpoint of stellar evolution. Einstein's theory of general relativity represents the highest development of classical physics. It made subtle modifications to Einstein's previous theory of special relativity, modifications that would require several decades for decisive experimental test. However, it was only a few years after Einstein had constructed this theory that its classical foundations would be swept away. The world is described by quantum mechanics. I now turn to what was, by a long way, the most important discovery of 20th century science. This is the fact that the world is described by quantum mechanics. No other scientific discovery, either before or since, has combined to the same degree foundational insight, philosophical significance, and technological impact. Not the discovery of DNA, not the laws of electromagnetism, and not even the theory of evolution. A scientific outlook, unenlightened by any contact with quantum mechanics, is partial and limited. Such an outlook produces a view of nature that is foreshortened and darkened, attached to an understanding haunted by pre-modern incubi. The importance of quantum mechanics is threefold. First, it overthrew classical Newtonian mechanics, a theory so successful and influential that the German philosopher Immanuel Kant saw it as an absolute truth, even almost a necessary one. The discovery of quantum mechanics showed that these fundamental laws of dynamics were wrong, both calculationally and conceptually, and not just for objects moving at close to the speed of light. Second, quantum mechanics has, through its uncertainty principle, permanently modified our ideas of what can be known, and even what it means to know something. Last and by no means least, quantum mechanics has had immense technological application. It is not only the foundation on which all of chemistry is built, but is also essential for the construction of devices ranging from lasers to semiconductors. Newton's laws provided a deterministic outlook for how matter.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.